So today we shall take care of few side remarks and certain left out things and so on. So this is not exactly a topic module, so I have called it as assorted topics. To carry on with whatever we are doing, namely study of length spaces, let me first give you a few more information on length spaces. So far considered only finite dimensional length spaces, namely from an odd dimensional sphere we made a group action and then take the quotient, right? Whereas we can do this in a more general fashion, namely you can keep on doing it because each time the action that we take in the next stage is an extension of the action that we take for the previous sphere. So S3 contained inside S5, S5 contained inside S7 and so on, we have been extending the action. Therefore, you can go all the way to infinite dimension sphere. Okay, so what will be the starting data there? Instead of finitely many q1, q2, qn numbers which are co-prime to P, you have a sequence of numbers which are co-prime to P. Okay, then all that you do is take this infinite sequence of complex numbers such that after a finite stage they are all zero. That is the meaning of this one, z0, z1, zn, etc. Sitting inside S infinity, thought of as the unit sphere in C infinity. Remember, C infinity is nothing but the direct sum of infinitely many copies of C, namely countably many copies of C. So zeta is a pth root of unity operating upon an element here z0, z0n, etc. will be first coordinate will be multiplied by zeta, second one by zeta power q1 and so on. Verification that this is fixed point free is just, it's already done, because what you have to do at each time, you have to verify it at the finite level. So all these verifications work out. This will be the quotient space, the quotient map will be a p-fold covering from S infinity to whatever space we get, we are denoting it as LP Q1 Q2 dot dot dot. So that is called infinite length space, infinite dimensional length space, whatever. It has some theoretical importance. I will let you know about it a little later. Right now, for coming back to finite simplicial complex, finite length spaces, there are some easy observations you can make. LPQ, remember this depends upon both P and Q, right? But there are some relations, namely LPQ is homeomorphic to LP minus Q. See, we never use that QIs are positive. The negative numbers are also allowed. Only thing is they should be co-prime to P. Okay. The same way you can define, instead of theta raised to some power Q, it's minus Q, no problem. So you take the same thing. But LPQ and LP minus Q are isomorphic, are homeomorphic, actually diffeomorphic. How to see this? Consider, there are many different ways of seeing. I am telling you one way. Consider the map S3 to S3 given by Z0, Z1 going to Z0, comma, Z0 raised to T times Z1, where T is some integer. It is immediately a smooth map, and its inverse is Z0, comma, Z0 raised to minus T Z1. Okay, so it is a diffeomorphism. Anyway, it is a homeomorphism. If you don't know what is a diffeomorphism. Now, for a special T, namely T equal to minus 2Q, you can verify that F actually becomes equivariant map from LPQ to LP minus Q. That is the meaning of the equivariant map. You take the PQ, the Q action on S3, okay? So compose it with F, it is same thing as phi of minus Q of F. So this S3 is equivariant under this map, which means that F boils down, factors down to a map from LPQ to LP minus Q, okay? Exactly similarly, its inverse will also boil down. They will be inverses of each other. So that defines a diffeomorphism of LPQ to LP minus Q. All that you have to do is you have to verify that F composite PQ is phi of minus Q composite F, which I have done here. Z0, Z1 under PQ would go to zeta Z0, zeta power Q Z1. Under F, it will go to zeta Z0, then I have to multiply zeta Z0 raised to minus Q, right, times zeta Q Z1, okay? So minus Q, zeta raised to minus Q, Z0 raised to minus anyway, so if there is some typos, you better change it. So you can directly verify it. Under PF, first this goes to Z0, Z0 raised to minus 2Q times Z1. And under minus Q, if we go to theta raised to minus Q, theta not raised to minus 2Q times Z. Both of them are equal. That is what I have verified anyway. So that is one thing. The second thing is, if Q and Q prime are such that one is inverse of the other, modulo P in the ring Z by ZP, these two numbers must be inverse of each other, namely Q Q prime is congruent to 1 mod P. Okay. Then again, LPQ will be isomorphic to or homeomorphic, diffeomorphic to LPQ prime. So for this, you look at the interchange in the factor, you know, permuting the factors T Z0 Z1 equal to Z1 Z0. That is a diffeomorphism. So what we can verify is T of PQ is same thing as PQ operated Q prime times composite T. Now PQ operated Q prime times or PQ operating upon any other square Q, whatever it is, they will give you the same orbit space as the action of PQ, because you have to take all the powers. The only thing is that the zeta that you have chosen should be a primitive nth root of primitive p th root of unity, then all the powers will repeat no matter what power you take. Okay, this means test T, I mean Q and Q prime are co-prime to 1, both, that is the important thing here. This means T is an equivariant diffeomorphism of the PQ action and PQ prime raised to Q action, which is equivalent to phi of Q prime, with the choice of the primitive root zeta raised to q instead of zeta. Because q is co-prime to p, zeta raised to q is also a primitive root of unity. Hence, LPQ is homeomorphic to LPQ prime. If you combine these two, you will get LPQ prime. Okay, I can put a minus sign. That is also homeomorphic to LPQ. Okay, so second factor, second number, p is the same first number, second number could be negative or inverse of, I mean, multiplicative inverse, additive inverse or multiplicative inverse. You can both combine. So that's what these classes will be the same of diffeomorphism, they are the same. Okay, what Rademaster has done is, he has complete classification of LPQs in a three-dimensional lens spaces. So this is a very classical reader. LPQ is homeomorphic to LPQ prime if and only if Q plus minus Q prime is zero or Q Q prime is plus minus one modulo P. Not only we just did it for Q Q prime equal to one here, but minus one will also do. So like that, we did it. See, Q equal to Q prime, there is no problem. Q equal to minus Q prime, we did this part. And here there is one more part. And the whole thing is if and only if. Okay. If this happens, then we have more or less seen the proof. The only if part is beyond the scope of this course. So that leads you to define what are called as Rademaster distortions and so on. So it's a deeper theory. Okay. So similarly, there is a theorem of Whitehead which gives you homotopy classification. So let me state that one. In any case, all these things are in a nice article by in 1973 by Cohen. So if you are interested in, you can read that one. That's all. So LPQ is homotopy equivalent to LPQ prime if and only if QQ prime is a square modulo P. Okay. So homotopy equivalence automatically takes care of homeomorphisms also. So this is a much larger result. So this is Whitehead's result. Okay. So I will let you know about infinite lens spaces. The strangeness with infinite lens spaces is it depends only on the first integer p. All of them, whether finite or infinite, the fundamental group of the LP, Q, Q1, Q2, or whatever, they all have fundamental group isomorphic to Z by PZ, the cyclic group of order P. That is true for infinite lens space also. But what happens is the covering, the P-fold covering S infinity is contractible. Even though it's a sphere, the infinite dimension sphere is contractible. From this one, one can deduce that no matter what Q1, Q2, Qn you take, all of them have the same homotopy type. Only the first P matters. LP, any sequence, is homotopy equivalent to LP, any other sequence. Okay? And these are important because they are what are called as Eilenberg-MacLane spaces, model for Eilenberg-MacLane spaces of type Z by PZ, comma 1. Okay? So, because these things are new to you, they may be only just an information sake. Okay? So, now let us go to another topic here, namely Euler characteristic revisited. Remember, in part one, we defined Euler characteristic of a finite simplicial complex. A finite simplicial complex has a finite sequence f naught, f1, f2, f3, okay, etc., fn, where fi's are the number of I dimensional simplexes in a k. So this fi, f naught, f2, this n tuple, n plus 1 tuple is called the phase vector in combinatorics. What we are interested in is the summation sign, which is missing here. Chi x, okay, is equal to summation minus 1 to the I fi of k. This is what we have done as the Euler characteristics of a finite simplicial complex k. For the simplicial chain complex C dot of k, we have another definition of the chi of ck for any chain complex which is finitely generated. We have another definition, and we have also seen that the other definition, namely alternative sum of the ranks of this C dot of k, is equal to the alternating sum of the ranks of the corresponding homology modules. Okay, that also you have seen. Okay, so because of that, and because of our study of the simplicial chain complex here, so what are the nth homology, or so what are the nth chain group in C dot K? What is CNK? It is just the free abelian group over the number of n cells. So it is just SNK, so FNK. Therefore, these two definitions are the same. Whether you use the simplicial chain complex to define the Euler characteristic, or directly do the way we have done it in part one. Okay, so these two things are same. That is important. Since we have also proved that the Euler characteristic of any chain complex is equal to Euler characteristics of its homology, okay, and since this one is canonically isomorphic to H star of mod k, now you see the Euler characteristic is independent of what triangulation you take, okay. So this leads us to define the Euler characteristic for topological spaces also, of course, with some restriction. Okay, anytime it has a simplicial complex structure, and if it is finite, namely, if you start with a compact space and then you give a simplicial structure, immediately Euler characteristic defined. No dependence on the simplicial complex, simplicial structure you choose. Therefore, you could directly define it from alternate sum of the ranks of H star of mod k, okay, of the underlying space. Therefore, it immediately begs for a definition. So, by the way, these things were done either time, you know, almost even slightly before than Poincaré. So, the rank of Hi of xk, this becomes an important invariant. It is called beta I of x. No matter what you know, whatever the choice of mod k or whatever choice of the triangulation, the rank of Hi of x doesn't depend upon that. So this I can always define. This may be finite, this may be infinite, and so on. For all spaces, you can define this. Beta I of x is rank of this one, and this is called ith Betti number of x. The alternate sum of ith Betti numbers If it is defined, that means what? If these things are all finite, then you call it as chi x. Even if one of them is infinite, then this is not defined. So because of topological invariance of homology groups, Betti numbers can be computed using any triangulation of a space, and the corresponding simplicial homology, provided of course, x is triangulable. Okay. We can go one more step ahead because now we know what is CW complex instead of a simplicial complex. Exactly same way we have studied the simplicial, the CW chain complex. Therefore, what we get is chi x, which is minus 1 raised to I beta I of x. Okay. This formula can be computed using any CW structure also. Okay. And using the CW chain complex also. So this is valid for finite CW complexes, which is slightly larger category than finite simplicial complexes. All these comments will apply to the Lefschetz number also. Recall what is the Lefschetz number of a continuous function from one topological space to another topological space, into the same topological space, f from x to x. Okay. Now suppose x is such that all its homology modules are finitely generated. Then take the induced homomorphisms f stars at each hi level. Look at the trace of those. These are linear maps. You can talk about the trace of this. Take the alternate sum. That is the definition of Lefschetz number. Okay. So this can be computed either using CW structure or using simplicial structure, etc., provided the map F is linear, cellular or simplicial, and so on. But final result says that it is independent of all that. It can define it for any map from any x to x, provided x has finitely generated homology. Okay, here is another kind of homology, cellular singular homology. We now come to this homology, which is between CW homology and singular homology of the underlying space. Okay. This is similar to the case of simplicial homology and singular simplicial homology of a simplicial complex. Okay. So take a CW complex. I am going to define a subgroup. What is the subgroup? The C cell N, like CCWN, I'm writing C cell N with a free abelian group generated by the set of all continuous maps, sigma from delta N to X, which are cellular. If you take all continuous maps, you get S dot, SN. If you take only cellular, then you get CN cell. Okay, so obviously, this free abelian group is a subgroup of SNX. Okay, this forms a subgroup of SNX, and the boundary operator is taken exactly the same way as in SNX. Therefore, not only that, if you take a cellular map, boundary of a cellular map is a cellular map. And that is why you can take the boundary. Boundary defined as in the SN can be taken as the definition of boundary here also. Okay. What happens is, if you take C dot cell N as direct sum of C N cells, along with this dhaba, it will be a sub-chain complex of S dot of X. Okay. Now look at what was CCW. CW of X was defined as a free abelian group only on the, what are the maps? Characteristic maps. One single characteristic map will define the one single N cell. I am taking one single N cell as a generator, as an element in the basis, right? So you can represent it by the one single, the characteristic map, which is automatically cellular. Therefore, CCW is a sub of C cell. Okay, so that is what we have. There is an inclusion, this inclusion map is a chain equivalence is a statement. Okay, but what we have is this C cell is a subgroup, is a subchain complex between CW and SX. So the statement here is that inclusion map is a chain equivalence. Therefore, when you pass to the homology, it will be an isomorphism. Okay, as usual, we will postpone the proof of this one. Okay, so this is what I had. CCW sitting inside, CCL sitting inside SX. Okay, and you can always take relative version of these things. We are not much going to use this one here, but understanding this one will be a must when you go to, you know, higher algebraic topology, like understanding Lillet space spectral sequence and so on. The spectral sequence idea actually, has roots in this kind of the CW complexes and this kind of substructures here on that. Okay, so let us stop here, and next time we will start doing applications of homology. Thank you.